breed, until it is of age or reunited with its own kind, you are a clan, too.
It is a time of uncertainty. For now, the child is safe, and he and the Mandalorian must search the galaxy for answers. But with few allies, danger lurks everywhere. And there's one enemy that will stop at nothing for the child's recapture. Join Cyber Wren and Dee Vizsla as they track the adventures of the Clan of Two.
Wherever I go, he goes.
This is the MandaLore Podcast.
This is the way.
Welcome to the MandaLore, the definitive podcast for the Mandalorian. We are back. We're bringing you a special show today, Sunday, February 7th, because it is Star Wars Podcast Day. And what that is that we're celebrating the first ever Star Wars-based podcast that debuted way back in 1999 on February 7th, and that one was called Jedi Talk. So with that, we're going to bring you some news, a little bit of chatter about things that are coming up. We're going to talk about a couple Star Wars books. We're going to talk about the Season 2 of The Gallery that was out a little while ago, and then a bit of a retrospective on Mandalorian Season 2. So with that, I am Cyber Wren.
And I am Dee Vizsla. Hope you missed us as much as we missed you.
indeed. I've missed my partner here, and I've missed our listeners, yeah. And talking Star Wars.
That's right. But we got a reason to come together. We've been talking about doing a show, but, you know, Star Wars Day, Star Wars Podcast Day, I should say, it was you know, I got reached out to by a gentleman named Daniel who organized this whole thing. He has a website called Star Wars NowThis.com, and it's a collection of all, he's been collecting all the Star Wars podcasts over the last, gosh, 6-7 months ago, I think he started doing this. I submitted us on there, so you can find The Mandalore on there. You can find Inside the Force on there.
Nice.
But it's a nice place, a nice collection. He's done a great job bringing the community of podcasters together. And he reached out to us and reached out to me and said, hey, we're trying to organize this thing. Do you want to be a part of this? And originally, I committed on Inside the Force, but I sent him a note a couple of days ago. I said, hey, Martin and I, we're going to do a Mandalore, so we're going to be a part of this thing too. So I think there's close to 100 podcasts that are putting out a show today.
Cool. That was my question. I was wondering how many shows are going to be part of this. That's neat. Great.
I think the last count was like 85, 86 or something like that, and he had others that had already committed that he didn't know about that were saying, hey, they were tweeting at him like, hey, we're going to do this too, you know, so.
Yeah.
It's well over 100, I think.
Well, that gets us in the spotlight just a little bit more. And I like
that's
that.
Right. That's right.
Yeah. Cool. Good work. Let's dive into our news section and talk about, I mean, there was a little bit of stuff that got dumped on our ears, you know, a month or so ago, and then it's kind of teetered off, but we got a few things we can just talk about and chat about. Let's do that. And we might actually just be refreshing you on a couple things that people may already have known about, but the Book of Boba Fett that is coming out, it'll actually be debuting December of 2021. That's this year. So it'll be out, I'm guessing, probably similar time that Mandalorian debuted, two weeks before Christmas, and it'll probably end right at Christmas time.
Yep, that sounds like about right. They're probably still shooting. They started shooting back in December while Mandalorian was still, you know, rolling out their episodes. So yeah. I don't know the episode count yet, but we will be getting the first one, the end of this year.
Yeah, I mean, there really isn't a lot of details. It's only speculation right now as to what it's going to be about. Is it going to be flashbacks? Is it going to be all brand new stuff? And, you know, obviously, the last time we saw him, he's in Jabba's palace. So what's going to go from there on out? Is he just trying to establish himself as, you know, a crime boss? We don't know.
Yep. He's definitely the crime boss. He's definitely taking over some kind of syndicate. Whether or not it's the whole Hutt cartel or if he's just going to work on his own, who knows?
Yeah, and what characters from the shows we already know will pay a visit. We don't know. I mean, it might be neat. Maybe Mando will stop by and say, hey, what's going on?
Well, I think it's definitely tying into the Filoni universe or Filoni Favreau universe that they're building with Ahsoka and Rangers of the New Republic. And I think this somehow will factor in as well.
Yeah, that'll be cool. So look forward to that. Now, as for season 3 of The Mandalorian, we did get a spark of news. It's not fully confirmed, but it looks like production is beginning this year on April 5th for that third season. And they had said along with that to expect the show to release sometime in the first half of 2022.
Yes. Unfortunately, we're going to be getting over a year. Going to be over a year till we get back to The Mandalorian, which it's crazy when you end on such a unbelievable episode that you have to wait all that time. But they're just making a lot more Star Wars content for Disney Plus, so
they are. But you know what this reminds me of? Game of Thrones.
Yes.
Yep. We waited a year and a half between seasons, and it's
that's right.
I mean, if you look at it, the way they ended season 2 with the big bomb of Luke Skywalker and showing up and everything and saying goodbye to Grogu, maybe they got to take a step back and really plot it out from here on, on forward. What are they going to do with the story? And we'll talk about that later in the show, but I think what they have to do is really take a look at it and make sure they plan it out properly, because I trust the writers to be able to do that and not just roll. We're popular, okay, rush more out, and then our show starts to weaken. So it sucks, but I'm expecting really high quality content with this type of time in between.
Right. Yep.
Yeah. Something that we can refresh you guys is on. You remember Fennec Shand, who became quite a favorite character. Ming-Na Wen, who played her, is also going to be voicing her in the upcoming Bad Batch cartoon, which is kind of a continuation of the Clone Wars. So she actually is going to be voicing the younger version of herself in that, and I think that's going to be fun.
I think it's going to be very cool. Yeah, and I got to say, I did not catch the debut of her in that trailer. I think it was you that actually pointed it out. And very excited about that. Yeah, get to see probably her origins and how she get wrapped up in the galaxy struggles, and it's gonna be cool. And I know she's pretty excited about it, being the Star Wars fan that she is.
Yeah exactly. And it's interesting, I'll throw this in, I forgot to put this in our notes, but we've been watching, me and my partner and her daughter have been watching Clone Wars, and we're good ways into season 3 now, and we just finished that episode where it goes way back in time to show the clones as cadets, and they're all just figuring out, they're calling each other, BT-5437, and they're we'll call you Heavy, and you're Echo because you keep repeating all the orders, and so it's neat to see that. And then you've got 99, who is the little deformed, hunched over kind of guy that, he obviously had troubles in his cloning batch. And they said, he's from the Bad Batch. Oh, you're the Bad Batch. And what's wrong with these guys? Oh, they're the Bad Batch. And I thought, now I'm starting to see the history all come together and be connected. All the way back in season 3 of Clone Wars, they're talking about the Bad Batch. And originally it was just because they were, clones that weren't formed properly.
Correct.
Or there was something wrong with them. Hence the Bad Batch, because they think of it as like they're baking goods or something.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So you're not watching, side note then, so you're not watching chronologically.
We're just watching release order, yeah.
Yeah, because there is a chronological order that StarWars.com has put out there.
Yeah.
For anybody that wants to, if they're starting it or wants to rewatch it, there is a chronological order, and that episode you're talking about is one of the first episodes that you should watch in order.
Yeah.
Because it is out of place a little bit.
Well, yeah, it's like the fifth episode of season 3 or something like that.
Yeah.
So. But it's okay. I think you sent me the link for that, and I looked at it when I began the show on my own. I was following that list, but now that I've gone back to the beginning of that, just because we're going on Disney Plus, they're in the release order on Disney Plus, so I thought, let's just go through it, because we sit down and we watch 3 or 4 episodes at a time, and I don't want to have to worry about jumping back and forth and trying to follow the list. And the girls seem to keep up with it fine. They understand that we just jump back in time and we're looking at the history, and it's okay. It makes sense.
Yep. Yep.
Well, it's fun. I mean, yeah, I remember you telling me because you were like, season one's a little bit, once you get to season two, it really takes off and really gets good. And I see what you were saying. I still enjoy it. I thought season one kind of got going halfway through. They finally picked
it up. Yeah, it does. Yeah.
It's good. I mean, it is. Here's a testament to how good it is. You and me are Star Wars fans, and we love this stuff. My partner, Lisa, she's like, I like the movie. Star Wars is okay, whatever. This is how good Clone Wars is. She's the one that's coming to me. Hey, are we going to watch a couple episodes tonight?
That's great.
So there you have it, guys. So if you haven't watched this show, there's a good way for you to weigh in on whether it's worth it or not. When I have a casual fan, I would say, not a non-fan, she's a casual fan who's excited and wants to schedule time ahead of the week to watch, Clone Wars, it's good.
It is good. and you're not even, I mean, wow, when you get into towards the end of 3 and 4, seeing it's incredible.
I think what we should probably do a Mandalore episode just to talk about Clone Wars, because a lot of things I want to kind of dive into, but I think what I'm enjoying the most about it is watching Anakin. Yeah. I mean, also enjoying Ahsoka and watching her story grow, because we just got her in live action finally, so I'm watching her grow through the Clone Wars, but it's Anakin's story that I really, really connect with, and just seeing how good he was before the dark side got a hold of him, before he got manipulated by Palpatine. He was such a good hero.
That's right.
Strong and the best Jedi there is, and just his personality and his character and the type of man he is, I'm really, really connecting to him, and I'm just like, God, it's such a shame that he took the path that he did.
Yep.
That Palpatine was able to manipulate him, because he is truly the ultimate hero in these early seasons of the Clone Wars, and it's just so much fun. I mean, I love it. He kind of gives me this Maverick feeling, like from the Top Gun movies. He's the young guy. Nothing can stop me. I'm hot.
Right.
And I love it. He's awesome.
Yeah, mine was the relationship with him and Obi-Wan. That's that really pays off in in episode 3, and you really get a backstory of how much they helped each other, how much they fought for each other, and.
Yeah,
it's a unique series. It definitely is.
Very, very good. And as soon as we're done that, we're going to do Rebels. And
Rebels is good too.
Yeah. All right. So back to the news. Tell us about these expected possibilities that we're getting. Two other characters that we would hope to see show up in live action might be actually making an appearance.
Of course, and Ahsoka is the live action debut that we got of her in The Mandalorian. She's getting her own show. No release date yet of when that's going to happen or when it's going to shoot, but Rosario Dawson is definitely coming back. Of course, we expect it to go down the road of Thrawn possibly being involved in that. Mm-hmm. But naturally, with Ahsoka, the last time we saw her prior to The Mandalorian was in Rebels, where she was with the specters of the Ghost crew, and two of those crew members was Sabine Wren and Captain Rex from the Clone Wars.
Yeah.
So rumors are that they will show up in Ahsoka. Sabine Wren was voiced by a woman named Tia Sakaar. So again, no word if she is a live action actress as well. So still no word yet whether or not she would be cast as Sabine. Captain Rex, which would have been played by, if he was in the movies, he would have been played by Temuera Morrison.
Yep.
But he was voiced by Dee Bradley Baker in The Clone Wars. But more than likely, we're talking about Temuera Morrison probably showing back up as Captain Rex, which would be awesome. I think fans would go crazy for that.
Yes, and that's what the rumor is that Temuera Morrison has got suddenly a super heavy workload in all these Star Wars shows, because he's going to be playing multiple characters, but Boba Fett and Rex and possibly some other clones.
Yeah, even in the Obi-Wan series, you know, there's rumors of that story going involving clones from the Clone Wars, and particularly Captain Commander Cody,
right,
who we saw that served under Obi-Wan in the Clone Wars. So he would be back for that as well, I'm assuming, if that part is true. So there's three characters right there that he would be playing in the live action series.
I would like to see, because this would be great for Tamora to stretch his acting chops and see, you know, can he play these different variants of the exact same clone? It'd be so much fun, and it sounds like he's excited. I mean, when you see some of the behind the scenes stuff, he just absolutely is thankful to get to be back in the Star Wars universe and all that it's given him, and to be able to, you know, in a way, kind of revitalize his career again in a bunch, because he's been, you know, skyrocketed to the spotlight again with this stuff. So yeah,
that's right. Yep. So,
cool stuff. Now here's something that we're gonna get into possibly on one of your other shows, but we're gonna mention it here a little bit, is that there's some video game news in the Star Wars world, and I'll let you explain it a little bit more, but Ubisoft is creating a brand new open world style Star Wars game, and that is what's got me excited, because that's the kind of games that I like to play.
Yes. So Lucasfilm Games was the big announcement, maybe early January, that came from Lucasfilm. Normally, LucasArts was where the gaming production happened out of Lucasfilm. Yeah. And they've had LucasArts has had an exclusive deal with EA over the last, I think, 10, 11 years. So we've gotten games like Battlefront and Battlefront 2 and Jedi Fallen Order and Squadrons recently. But now that contract is not getting renewed exclusively. So Lucasfilm Games is being created to carry on the production of games, and it's being spread out to multiple companies now. So we should be getting a major influx of games across multiple
because
platforms.
Because there's more than one company that can now work on them. And yeah, exactly. Which I
correct.
Think is fantastic. Yeah.
Fantastic. You're going to get more mobile games. You're going to get more VR games. You're going to get more, you know, console games, PC games. I mean, it's going to be a massive influx of games over the next few years. Ubisoft did mention, yes, that they are working on, they've been working on an open world game. That's the beauty of it, too, is even though that exclusivity was there, that didn't mean these other companies could at least start developing the games. They couldn't release them, but they could develop them. So they've been developing these games over the last couple of years, apparently. And as soon as that deal runs out, which I think is early next year, then you're just going to see a bunch of games coming out, I think. So, and EA said that they are announcing some Star Wars games that they've been working on as well. There's a rumor that they've been working on Battlefront 3, of course, another Jedi Fallen Order game, stuff like that. So, there's going to be a lot of these open world type games, a lot of these campaign driven games, story driven games. It's just going to be in VR. You know, there's definitely going to be more VR games, which I really enjoy
those ones.
So it's I've been dying for games, because to me, you know, it's the movies, it's the TV shows. I get into the books, but I get into the games first. So right after the live action stuff, the gaming is what I want to get into.
Yeah, no, I hear you. And I think looking at all this release schedule stuff that's coming out, I think I'm going to have to retire early just so I can have the time to fit in all the TV and the gaming and listening to the audiobooks. It's crazy. Like, I mean, because these games,
I know,
especially an open world game, I mean, that you can just get lost in it. There's no end. When it's an open world, there's no end. You can follow the story if you want to, but there's all the side quests and different things. You can just disappear in it. And that's the type of games that I play between Conan Exiles and Guild Wars 2. I just get lost. You could just spend all day wandering around doing nothing, really, but you're lost in this game world. And can you imagine a Star Wars game like that? Like, just you know, train yourself as a whatever and hop on your ship and off you go, exploring the galaxy on your own, doing what you want. Like,
I know. I can't wait to do it. I can't wait to spend all weekend after weekend just
calling in sick.
Exploring the galaxy.
Yep.
Take a couple days. I know, right? It's going to be so neat.
Definitely. So that's exciting news coming forward for that. Now, talking about season 3 of The Mandalorian, I threw this in the news section because we were wondering about Moff Gideon, and we can talk a little bit more about him later in the show, but I saw an interview with Giancarlo Esposito, and I don't know if he let this slip by accident, but he said in the interview, he said that they had asked him if he's going to be back, and he's like, oh, I have a good feeling we'll be seeing him again in season 3. And I wonder if he wasn't supposed to say that, but according to him, like, that to me is a pretty good intent, you know, a signal that he's coming back.
Yeah, I would think so. I mean, a big name like him, you know, he's part of the show. So unless he dies, I think he'll be definitely a part of it. So they're going to, somehow he'll make his way back. Don't know what that is yet, but he'll be definitely a part of it. But I don't think he'll be any more, he won't appear as much as, more than what he does now, I think.
So. I think he's part of the story, though. You can't have an actor like that and a villain like that just simply be done by the end of the season. I think they'll find a way to work him in for sure. Yep. So this is news, but it's like old news from like 1979, 1980 news. I was listening to another podcast called Stuck in the 80s. I don't know if you heard of that one. And they just talk all about 80s stuff, 80s TV, 80s music, 80s movies. And they were reviewing the old Flash Gordon movie. And talking about it. And so they go into a lot of behind the scenes stuff, and there's a documentary that got released about Flash Gordon, the making of, and all that kind of stuff. And there's a story in there which connects to Star Wars, which I found really, really interesting. George Lucas wanted to direct Flash Gordon, like co-direct with the director that did do it, Mike Hodges, way back in 1979 or 1977. It would have been 77 because it was before he got Star Wars. They were planning to do this Flash Gordon movie, which got released in 1980. But Mike Hodges didn't want to share the credit of directing. So George got very upset and he left the production. And he went on to write his own space opera, a little something known as Star Wars. Now, which do you think was more successful, Star Wars or Flash Gordon? Not many people know about Flash Gordon, and
No.
So I find it fascinating that this is way back when they're, you know, just fresh out of film school and stuff together, that they both love Flash Gordon. They both love the story and wanted to bring it to life. And he refused. So George Lucas to kind of one up him and say, well, screw you. I'm going to go write my own space opera.
Yeah.
The rest is history.
It's funny because I think I read in the news that they are actually trying to remake Flash Gordon right now. Think that's actually happening.
Imagine that. I mean, if any of you have seen it, it is some seriously cheeseball stuff. I mean, it's real 80s comic strip campy kind of thing. It's fun and it's goofy, but it's not the type of space movie you would expect, like a Star Wars type of thing. It's a comic book in space, basically.
But it was very serial driven, and that's why Star Wars is very serial driven, you know, with the crawl and all that stuff. Yeah. I mean, he was definitely influenced by Flash Gordon.
There you go. Fun little fact. All right. The last thing we're going to talk about in the news here, because you guys know during the finale of Mandalorian, we're releasing all this news about all these new shows coming out. And you guys were wondering how many of them are we going to cover and all that kind of stuff, and we had said we're covering most of the ones that are going to be all connected together. So you probably want to know when that's all coming. What's next? What's next for The Mandalore? Well, the closest thing, which we think is due to release sometime this spring, is the animated series Bad Batch, which is continuing the Clone Wars stories. If you guys watched the season 7, there's a 4-episode story arc about the Bad Batch. It was absolutely fantastic, and me and Vizsla covered it here on the show. So that's what's coming first, is the Bad Batch in spring. After that, is the Book of Boba Fett, and that's not until the end of the year. So we're going to actually be quiet for most of the summer and early fall, I guess, until December.
Oh, I will say, and I don't think there's a release date yet, but I think that anime Star Wars Visions, right? Series, I actually think that's coming out this year.
That might fill in the gap,
well,
maybe, eh?
But it's not related, you know, really related to the timeline.
No, we might, if they release that, we might come in and just do a one-off special episode just to say, hey, watch this or don't watch it kind of thing, but we're not going to cover it week to week or anything. So Bad Batch in spring, Book of Boba Fett, December. Then after that, it's kind of a toss-up as to what's coming next. We got Mandalorian Season 3, we got Cassian Andor, and we got Kenobi. It sounds like, roughly based on the production schedules and what's going on, that Season 3 of Mandalorian might come out first, with Cassian Andor hot on its heels and possibly with a little bit of crossover, and then after that, Kenobi. And that's all in, what, which is 2022 or 2023?
2022.
Okay, so, yeah, we'll basically have two shows to cover this year, and then, you know, whatever bonus stuff there is in between, and then, yeah, 2022, there'll be a full-on release of a lot of stuff suddenly, so.
Yeah, it could be a season two of Book of Boba Fett in 2022, at the end of 2022. We don't know that either, but.
Yeah, we don't know, so.
It's possible.
So there you go. That's really what's coming, what you guys can look forward to. Of course, we'll always keep you in the know. Just keep an eye on our Facebook page and Twitter account, and we'll listen for us here. Of course, we'll come and tell you as soon as we know. But let's get into overall impressions and ratings.
May the Force be with you.
You might be wondering, what the heck are they going to rate right now? There's nothing on. Well, I've done a thing over the last couple of months while we've been sitting here idle. I went and listened to two audiobooks and the new Star Wars stuff, the canon books, because I've been listening to Vizsla over on his Inside the Force talking about these, and on his Beyond the Saga show that he does, reviewing all the books.
Yes.
And I picked two out. I went and got myself a membership with Audible, and you get a couple free downloads when you start a membership, so I picked two Star Wars books, and that's what we're going to talk about just for a couple minutes here, because I love audiobooks. I'm with Vizsla. I don't have the time to actually flip pages. I can throw on my headphones at work and listen to an audiobook all day, and that's how I can get through them.
It's nice. Yeah. I do mind driving to work.
Yeah. So the first one we're going to talk about is Master and Apprentice. And this is a story about Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan when Obi-Wan was young and just a Padawan. And I'm going to start off right away, because you guys on your Beyond the Saga, you do 5-star ratings, or ratings out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
So that, which narrows it down and makes it a little bit trickier to be precise than out of a 10 rating. So this one, I was trying to think, how much did I like it? I liked it, but it wasn't, for me, it wasn't amazing. So I'm giving it a 3 out of 5, which is good. It's pretty good.
Good.
I mean, it's not terrible or anything. And just a couple of things that I liked about this. I liked hearing some of the history between Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan when he was much younger. Before we get to Episode 1, Phantom Menace, it was interesting to see how Obi-Wan was trained as a Padawan and what led to him being the type of Jedi and master that he becomes. And you can see a lot of it where it come from with Qui-Gon. But I also found that Obi-Wan was a lot different than I'm Qui-Gon, it's Qui-Gon. I keep saying it should be Qui-Gon, not Qui-Gon.
Qui-Gon, yeah.
Qui-Gon was quite loose in his beliefs, and he was the one that was a little bit more, I would say, like Anakin, like questioning a lot of the Jedi masters and you know, what's the right thing to do and what's the proper thing to do. So I found that actually really, really fascinating.
Yeah, definitely. I think Qui-Gon has a different view of what the Jedi should be and what they are when we meet him in Episode 1. So this book was really good in the fact that it gives you that in-depth look at why that is. And that's why I really liked it, was the it really dives into a lot of the prophecies, not just the prophecy, but a lot of different prophecies that he studied and researched. And, you know, that he just believed in all that stuff. And, I thought it was really good. I thought it was a really good book.
Yeah, it was. But I think that the problem with me between these two books that we're going to talk about here is I found this one to be a little bit on the slower, dull side. There were some good scenes and stuff, but I found it kind of dragged a little bit. There wasn't as much excitement, and I found the characters not as engaging to stick with my memory, because when I get to the next book, it stuck with me a lot longer, and I still remember a lot more parts about it. So that's where I found this one a little bit on the dull side. It just didn't have a lasting effect with me. But what I did really like about it, and this stands top-notch above most audiobooks that I ever listened to, was the voice acting. I don't know if you... Do you know the guy's name that voiced that one?
Was Jonathan Davis that did that one.
He's not only the narrator for the story, but he does all of the voices for all the characters, for Qui-Gon, for Obi-Wan, for everybody. This guy sounds exactly like Liam Neeson and Ewan McGregor. You can't even tell. You swear, what? They actually got those guys to read their parts in this book? That's crazy. He is that good. I mean, the voice acting alone is a 5 out of 5, for sure.
Yes. Yeah, agreed. I'm a really big fan of Mark Thompson, but Jonathan Davis is right there next to him. He's pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah. So really good stuff. Story, it was good, just a little bit slow for my taste, I think, but voice acting, I mean, top notch. Now, when we get to the second book, which is called Bloodlines, this one I'm rating a 4 out of 5. I love this one. It was a wonderful story revolving around Princess Leia in the times after Return of the Jedi, but before Force Awakens. It's a time, we never really got a lot of Leia. When you actually step back and think about it, she was a little bit more of a supporting role for Luke and Han, who tend to get more of the center stage, you would say, of anything. So to get a story that's completely focused on Leia, and Luke and Han are, I mean, Luke's not even in it. Han comes in and makes a couple guest appearances, but it's completely focused on her. It's dedicated just to who she was and what she can get into on her own. It just really fleshes out the hero that we know her to be. It really allowed you to get to see how Leia deals with things on her own. And man, I really love that, because, I mean, and maybe I'm being a little bit, because we miss Carrie Fisher and we miss having Princess Leia with us. Maybe I was a little bit leaning a little heavily towards liking this one better because of that, because this was a full story about her. I don't know. But what did you think of Bloodlines?
No, I love Bloodlines. I'll mention, too, that both of these books are actually written by the same author, Claudia Gray, which she has been killing it on the Star Wars books. She wrote these two books. She wrote a book called Princess Leia, which is really good. I advise everybody to read that. And she did one that's arguably, in the Star Wars community, one of the best books ever out there in the canon. It's called Lost Stars. And then she has Into the Dark, which just debuted last week as part of the High Republic series. So she's a fantastic Star Wars writer, and Bloodlines is probably in my top three books out there. It's the Leia story is incredible. You do get that gap filler a little bit in between 6 and 7. You get the discovery of the First Order in this. You get questions, you know, you feel like Leia, where she doesn't really know what's happening with Ben and with Luke. Of course, the whole Vader thing that happens in it. I mean, it's incredible. I could not stop listening to this thing when I was listening to it.
I went through it really quick. Yeah, without giving too much away, but the whole story, or the whole part of the story when people start finding out that Darth Vader is her father, I mean, that is just, it's breathtaking writing, and how she has to deal with it, and, you know, deal with the repercussions of all that. It's amazing. It's amazing writing. And to compare the two books, it's interesting they're written by both this Claudia Gray, that this one to me just stands out way more, because I found after I read this one, the character stuck with me. The story stuck with me. I just found it way better developed and much more interesting to keep up with. And I don't know. There was something about this one. It was just way more fleshed out and had had a sense of urgency and a sense of, you know, consequence and uh-oh type of moments. And I, you know, I mean, when she gets kidnapped and, you know, by the underground, you know, criminal underground, and she gets kidnapped. I mean, there's just so much that happens to her, and Leia has to get herself out of it. She doesn't have any, you know, Han Solo come to her rescue or anything. So it's great. And now the thing that I'm going to harp on a little bit here, and don't take this as any knock on anything, you know, with today's insensitivities. The voice acting was 50-50 for me. For Leia and some of the other characters, I absolutely loved it. She sounded like Leia. It made me feel like I was listening to Carrie Fisher, you know, just with the attitude and the way she spoke and everything. But what I had an issue with, what it was hard for me, was listening, because it's voice acted by a female. When she does the male parts, when she's voicing Han Solo or C-3PO, I could not get past it. I couldn't accept a female sounding Han Solo or C-3PO. It just didn't sound right to me. And by the end of the book, I was still like going, I don't like it. They should have brought in a couple voice actors to be able to play a few different parts. And I guess that the same goes to when the guys voice some of the lady parts, but this one just really bothered me, especially Han Solo and C-3PO. It just did not sound like them. It didn't sound like Han at all to me. And C-3PO just sounded like a female droid. We've seen female variants of the, you know, the 3PO droids in the movies, and that's what he sounded like. So I was like, no, that's not them. I just couldn't get past it.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on that. I've thought of that from the beginning too, because, you know, especially my first audiobook that I listened to was actually Ahsoka. When I listened to that, the great thing about that is they got Ashley Eckstein to come in and narrate that book, right? So yeah, you have Ahsoka telling the story about Ahsoka, and she sounds obviously like Ahsoka, but, you know, she does do all the other voices, and she wasn't as skilled to change her voice that much, right? So you basically just got Ahsoka narrating the story, which was still pretty good. Very similar to when you get to the Queen's Peril and Queen's Shadow, the books about Padme, Queen Amidala. They got Catherine Tabor to voice those, who voiced her in the Clone Wars.
Okay.
So pretty incredible. But yeah, when you get into these books like this where you have a male that's, obviously they got her name is January Lavoie. They got her to voice the Bloodlines book because it is female dominant, you know, with Leia being the center of the character.
Yeah, but that makes sense.
But totally, I agree with you that I think it would help so much if you just got one male character to do the male voices, and it would sound like a full ensemble cast.
Yeah,
but, you know, there's money involved, I'm sure. So they're not going to do that. But I agree with you, because Mark, like I said, Mark Thompson, who's my favorite of these, because he's incredible. I mean, the voices, he could do every one of those voices. When it comes to Yoda or Han or Thrawn, he's incredible. Even Tarkin, he's really good. But he doesn't sound like a female when he does Leia or somebody. So, but it's all right. You know, you get past it.
Yeah, I mean, it didn't take her. She was great as Leia and great as the couple of other female characters that were in the book. But it just, the story was just so good that it's fine. It's just something I wanted to touch on here, because it just surprised me that they went that way. Because I have heard audiobooks before where there is three or four people doing the voices. And I mean, I listen to podcasts, you know, these, I guess they call them audio dramas. And it's just, it's instead of being a podcast like us, they read a chapter every week. Or every episode is a chapter in this audio drama, and they've got a full-on cast, you know, anywhere from 3 to 12 voice actors voicing the parts. So if they can bring in an ensemble, then why can't an audiobook?
Right. Yeah. So,
yeah. That's the talk of the books. I rated Master Apprentice 3 out of 5 and Bloodlines 4 out of 5. What did you feel in both of them?
Both of them for me are 4 out of 5s.
Okay, cool.
And I would probably put Bloodline right above I really like the Master and Apprentice, but there's aspects of Bloodline that put it right above it. So,
yeah.
So Master and Apprentice probably in my top three still. Bloodline's probably two, and Masters is three. Yeah.
Cool.
So
I'm counting on you guys to tell me what to read. So that's where I'm gonna. Next on my list is From a Certain Point of View, Empire Strikes Back edition. I downloaded that one.
Well, you should do the Star Wars A New Hope one first. That one is pretty incredible.
This one just popped in my Audible feed first because
that was the most because it just came out.
Yeah, you get one free credit every month, so I've just been every month I download a new Star Wars book for free, so it's great.
Yes.
But then I also just picked, I thought I'm going to try it. I don't want to be behind. I got one of the new High Republic books, Star Wars Light of the Jedi. Mm,
good. Yep. So I just started that one. Yep.
Cool.
Now that's written by Charles Soule, who is
fantastic.
He's actually a fantastic comic writer. So interesting to see what his novels do, because this is the first novel I think he's done in the Star Wars canon.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I look forward to getting into it. Let's move into some chatter.
This is the way.
All right, some gallery chatter. We're going to talk about season two of The Gallery, and we're not going to get into it too deep here. I was just going through it and writing down a bunch of fun points that we really enjoyed and just gives us something to talk about. So I don't know how many of our listeners watched season two. If you love behind-the-scenes stuff, that's what this one was more about. Whereas season one, they did a roundtable discussion with all the directors. This one was more really a typical making-of featurette, where there's just tons of behind-the-scenes stuff with little mini interviews, you know, throughout it. And so going through that, I still think it's worth watching if you're interested in how things are made and what things look like and what the cast and the directors and the all the crew have to go through to make the show happen. I think it's fascinating. I love this kind of stuff. The first point I have here is seeing a scene with George Lucas on set, and he's there during the Ahsoka episode, and him and Rosario Dawson are sharing a laugh. I just thought that's pretty special to have George come visit the set and see some of these characters that he helped create come to life. That must've been pretty special.
Yeah, I totally agree. Love seeing it down there. I think they released a photo of that, you know, during the season or something like that. But I hope he's enjoying what he's seeing, because I think Filoni, you know, he's got to be really proud of Filoni for carrying on his legacy, because he is a Lucas clone. I've always said Filoni is like a Lucas clone. It's great.
Well, if he grows his beard out a little bit more, he might start looking like
him. Actually he would.
Yeah. So you guys remember the first episode where we see Cobb Vanth wearing Boba's armor, and him and Mando have to go fight that big dragon in the desert, the Krayt dragon? I found it really fascinating to find out that as they were creating this thing, it kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger until Jon Favreau was happy with it. And by the time he was happy with it, that dragon on screen was 600 feet long.
Yes.
Wow.
It actually looks a lot bigger. The head of that thing looks massive. I mean, the head of it looks, gosh, I don't know. It just looks like longer than 600 feet, but maybe I can't even put it in perspective really what 600 feet is. That's two football fields, right?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. So put string two football fields side by side or back to back.
I guess that's about right. Yeah, that's
200 yards. Right.
Yeah. 100 yards, 300 feet. Yeah. Two football fields. So that would be pretty massive. Yeah.
That would be terrifying. Jeez.
I know. It's the thought of that living on a planet and how many are there out there like that? You know, it's like.
Yeah. Yeah, and then when it's hungry, it comes to your town to look for food.
Man.
Yeah. No thanks. Freaky. Freaky. Now, sticking on measurements, I found this surprised me, this one. We talked last season on The Gallery about the volume. That's when we found out that the volume was this wonderful big studio that's just made up of super bright LED screens where they put all their background effects on, and that's why instead of having to go on location to shoot, they just shoot in front of these big super screens that they can put up all their graphics and their backgrounds and their locations and everything on, and the people are just on this little stage acting in front of these big massive curved TV screens. Absolutely love the idea. And they're talking about in this second season of the gallery how they increased this. This year we made the gallery much bigger, you know, to incorporate all those things that we wanted to do. And then they go and say the volume is only 100 feet long. I thought, wow. And they made it bigger. I thought it would have been a lot larger than that. But I think, and when you say 100 feet is
100 feet, like, pretty long. That? Yeah. I mean,
I guess, but it's also curved too. So it's 100 feet around. I'm thinking more like a semicircle.
Yeah. I think the diameter they're saying is 100 feet.
100 feet across.
Yeah.
Okay.
So before, the diameter was a lot smaller. It did feel like when you saw some behind the scenes of last year, it did look a lot more condensed, you know, that the practical part of it was really small. But the curvedness of it makes it seem very vast. And they're able to do bigger sets now with that 100 feet. And I imagine it's just going to keep getting bigger.
Just keep getting bigger. Well, it's 20 feet high. And I just saw an article earlier this week, actually, that Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 is going to be using the volume to film on.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So that's kind
of
cool.
Yeah, a lot of the Disney Plus Marvel series are going to be using it as well.
Yeah. Well, why wouldn't you, right? Look at what it's accomplishing, yeah.
Oh, movies. There's going to be a ton of movies that are going to use it.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? One thing I totally forgot to put in our news. The Mandalorian has been nominated for a Golden Globe for Best TV Series.
That's right. Yes, it has.
That is that's one of the only nominations it has, but Best TV Series? That's like an all-encompassing category to win.
That's right. Yep.
Wow.
I can't remember, but it's got some strict competition, but it's definitely an honor. I mean,
yeah,
a globe is incredible. Yeah.
Well, and the fact, because sci-fi never wins, it barely even gets nominated.
I know.
But winning ever a sci-fi series, never. It's unheard of.
Yeah.
So the fact that Mandalorian is up in there, I mean, I think it's got a good chance. We'll have to see. So, and the Golden Globes are soon too, I think.
Yeah, they're usually in February.
Yeah, so awesome stuff. Now, when we're watching The Mandalorian and we see Grogu in his little carrier, he's always floating along beside Mando. And I always thought it's got to be CGI. They must have somehow CGI'd it in. But it turns out that it's actually very similar effects to what they use land speeders for. His cart is actually on a little, some type of cargo cart of some kind. There's four wheels and I don't know what you call it, like a scissor platform or something that it's sitting on, and it's driving around like an RC car. And that's why it's able to keep up with Mando, and it's able to just ride along super smooth right beside him, and all they do is you know, digitally remove the cart. And that surprised me. That's exactly what they did for the land speeders. The land speeders are actually on wheels driving around, and they just digitally remove all that to make it look like it's floating off the ground. But I thought that was cool to see his little carrier is actually on wheels.
Yeah, the practical, they're just using as much practical as they can. It's great.
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah.
Now, do you remember talking in the episode when the Gamorreans showed up in the underground fight arena, and we saw the axes?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, they're like shooting this big force field or something. Like, it looked like they were hitting something, and we thought, well, I wonder why that is. Maybe they don't want to kill their fighters. Why is there this big electrical boom happening when they strike each other? And it's not force fields, according to this gallery behind-the-scenes stuff. It's that the axes actually have electricity in them. They're fired up with electricity so that when they do connect, there's an explosion of sparks.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, so those guys are getting hit by the axes. Okay.
Yeah. That's pretty neat. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Cool stuff. Just fun little things like that. So this one maybe we can get into a little bit, because I found this really, really cool. Jon Favreau enforces the realism in the filming. And this, I think this was Bryce Dallas Howard that was telling the story. She says that the way he wants it is if you can't actually do it, you can't film as if you were there in the scene filming with cameras, then he doesn't want you faking it with cranes and devices and cables or all that. He says, film it how you would actually be there to able to do it. Like, keep it grounded, keep it based in reality. So if you're out in a ship and you're filming a ship going across the ocean, don't have the camera up in the sky flowing over, because you can't do that. The camera needs to be on the ship or in a ship that's beside it capturing the footage. He wants it filmed the only way possible you could do it, as if you were actually there. And I thought that's so cool, because that just brings in it grounds it basically, and it brings so much realism to what we're watching, because the cameras can only be there the way we as characters would be part of that scene carrying the camera. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense. You know, the thing about it is with drone technology these days, I mean, you can pretty much get almost any shot you want.
That is true.
So, because there is still that shot when they're on the boat, is what seems like a big drone shot that comes down and sees the boat really wide, yeah, and comes down and sweeps right up to them. But from there, it's everything it happens on the boats. Like the camera's there. But you know, it's these days, yeah, it's just, if you want to be practical and not include a bunch of CGI, then yeah, you've got to think about how you would shoot something like that in real atmospheres, real practical locations.
Yeah. I think it's cool. It
connects it with the 77 movie, which is what Favreau is trying to do, I think, you know, still keep that same type of feeling.
Yeah, exactly. And make it as real as you could. And that's why they didn't CGI characters. It's all, you know, prosthetics and makeup and everything. Like, they wanted to keep it as real as they could. So I just like that. I think it's really cool. Good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about Ahsoka's lightsabers, because we talk about the technology of lightsabers and, you know, how it's mostly digitally composited and whatever afterwards and post-processing. But Ahsoka's lightsabers here actually light up. You can see her carrying that. It looks like she's carrying two tubes, like two fluorescent tubes with her. But they can handle the fighting and everything. But it's neat. She actually turns them on and you can see the whole rod light up like a lightsaber does. It doesn't have the crazy crackling glow, but the stick itself lights up. And I like how they said that by having these lightsabers light up, it actually creates realistic lighting on set in the scene, so that the cameras can be placed properly to capture the best angle and the best, you know, the mood that it creates, because the light is actually there. They don't have to digitally alter it, and they don't have to add a bunch of light to the set to, you know, to get the glow on the face that they want, because the lightsabers are providing that glow. And I love stuff like that. I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, they actually, J.J. Abrams actually did this for Episode 7, which was the first time that on set they used glowing lightsabers.
Oh, cool.
If you watch some behind the scenes of that, the final fight, you know, with Rey and Kylo, you know, the force, you know, the metal force effects sabers that you can buy that have the metal hilts and the white glows. So the white tubes that glow when you turn them on. But what I read was they modified those a little bit and actually put the set of a white blade, they put up the colored blade, the red. So like Kylo's is red and Rey's was blue. So that would have that glow. So when you're seeing him fight, and that there's that part where, you know, they clash and he's saying, I'll teach you, you know, and you could, the light that's on their face is from the sabers. Now they got to go in and do the CG part of it that makes it look like a lightsaber.
Yeah.
But the light is there, and, you know, hers is obviously unique because they're white. There's no color. So it's just literally just a white bulb. But no, you know, it makes me think back to, I know you couldn't do it back in the original trilogy, but in the prequels, it made me think that, surprised Lucas didn't think of something like that, because those back then were still metal rods that they had to, because you would have got a lot better lighting effects with that. And I don't know if you remember this, but in episode 2, when Dooku is fighting Anakin, there's at one point where, if you remember, when they're fighting, Anakin slides, you know, like kind of hits a low shot and hits a pipe that kills the lighting. So there's no overhead lights in the scene anymore. And all that's there are his blue saber and Dooku's red saber. And they hold them up in their kind of high in the sky. And you can see all the light you can see is from the sabers, the blue and the red. And you can see their faces. But they never, because they used actual glowing rods, they never clashed. They never actually hit each other. So it's kind of a fake way to do it. It was because when they cut wide and they finally started clashing, then all of a sudden the glow on their face was gone and they were silhouetted, right?
Right. Yeah.
So I noticed that right away when I remember watching that movie for the first time. Like, oh, well, that's cool. Why wouldn't they use glowing lightsabers? I mean, you can figure that out, I would assume. And well, JJ ended up doing episode 7, and that's the way they've been doing it ever since.
Yeah. It's cool. I mean, it is cool. You have the light right there with the actor, so that it saves so much production work to try to recreate that light afterwards. So, yeah, that's cool.
Which they don't. That's the thing, is that they don't put the effort in to try to show that light on their face. So if you watch, like, the original trilogy or the prequels, you never see the light in their faces. Yeah.
But when you look at this episode with Ahsoka, when she's fighting the magistrate at the end there, the white just lights both of them up. And it's so cool. That's when you see Ahsoka's eyes and, oh, yeah, I mean, she looked great.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Now, staying on Ahsoka, it was neat to see her when she's getting into her costume, that her headpiece with the, what are those things called? The leku?
Leku, yeah.
Leku, yeah, like the big tails coming off her head. The whole thing is just a headband. And she just puts it on her head, and there you go. And that's pretty cool. I mean, that makes it pretty easy. It's not difficult to get in and get out of, so.
Right.
And there's the video. We all saw the picture, because I think Jon Favreau posted it on his Twitter account, but they actually had the video of George Lucas holding little baby Grogu, and I thought that's just a beautiful, beautiful thing to see.
Yes. Totally. You know, her with... or him with Ahsoka was a good moment. And then, with Grogu, to see his whole Yoda species used in a way like that is pretty neat.
Yeah. And he was still being animated, too. So
yeah.
He must have. I noticed the camera didn't swing around too much to show his. We were kind of getting a side perspective, but I would love to have seen his face full on to see if he's actually tearing up a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
Because he looked like Grandpa. His Grandpa holding his grandson. That's what it looked like. Awesome stuff. There's a cool scene with Temuera Morrison singing a blues song about the Mandalorian in one of the tents. I thought that was fun to see.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
He's just getting down, breaking down, and he's singing this blues song, you know, this little bluegrass, and it was pretty fun. Everybody's toe-tapping, getting into it. Now, do you remember when we were talking about what was the episode called when Mando and had to break into the Imperial base with the tanks? What was that? Which episode was that?
That was before the last one, right? So that was chapter 15.
Yeah, the last one.
Yeah.
Can't remember the title of the episode for some reason, but
it's right there. I don't know why I can't.
That's okay. But you remember when we were discussing that episode and I was going crazy about the action sequence when they were on the road in the tanks and Mando had to go on the roof of the tank, and they kept having those speeder carts coming after them with all the bandits on them, and the bandits kept jumping off the carts to the tank. And there's that one real cool scene from a faraway perspective, and you could see all the bandits running and jumping, and they're in this beautiful, like, ballet type of motion or together. Like, everything was so synced up really nicely, where they're one by one, they're jumping onto the back of the tank. And I thought, man, that was absolutely beautiful. I wonder how they did that. And you get to see that scene being made in this gallery session this time. And you see that they're all hooked up to cables, and there's these, you know, like it almost look like a clothesline above them. There's two long cables above their heads, and they're all strapped in with cables themselves. And as they were jumping from their cart to the tank, the cable was pulling them along, and it just gave this beautiful, smooth action. And I don't know, I love seeing how action stunts and stuff get put together like that. And yeah, because I like that scene so much, it was neat to see that, you know, that's how they did it. It's all cable work. Cool.
Very cool. The Believer is what it was called.
The Believer, that's what it was, right? Yeah,
good. No, stuff. Great good stunt stuff. Work. Yeah, it's great to see that.
See how it all comes together. Mm-hmm. I also liked how they showed putting the spaceships together as miniatures, and when they were building the one, you know, Star Destroyer. I mean, it's you call it a miniature in comparison to the actual Star Destroyer, but the model itself was like 10 feet long.
Yeah, right.
But the guy building it, it was so cool how intricate this model was, and the way they showed it on a track, and it's just sitting there, and the cameras were sliding by it on a track to create the, you know, the scene when the ship flies overhead or whatever. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I thought, here it is, 2020, and they're filming this stuff exactly like Lucas did in the 1970s with the miniatures. That's right. And yep, the cameras. And just cool.
Yeah, I remember last year they showed John Knoll doing the flybys of the Razor Crest just in his garage.
Yeah.
He just shot it in his garage. It's crazy.
It is crazy stuff. Now, here's something that shocked me, because I swear this was CGI. I had no idea this was real. Those Dark Troopers were actual actors in Dark Trooper suits.
Yes.
I could not believe that. I thought...
I couldn't either. Yeah.
That blew me away. And the only thing that wasn't real on them was their joints. The knee joints, the elbow joints, and the wrist joints were CGI added in afterwards, because it showed gears and pulleys and stuff moving around, so the actors didn't have that as part of the suit. But the helmet, the chest, the legs, the arms, everything there was actual actors. So just imagine really souped-up stormtrooper outfits. That's what these Dark Troopers were. Very cool. I mean,
did not see that coming.
The scene when it showed the guys when they were punching in the door, and you saw the two actors just, k-tuh, 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 just, you know, they're like, ready, 3, 2, 1, punch. And they had to be in unison with each other. I was like, this is cool. This completely threw me off. Loved it. Now, I also, the last point I have here is the respect for Jabba's palace. They showed Jon Favreau walking around on the set, and they showed the director, and they were talking about, look at the ceiling, look at everything. Like, this is, I think it was Jon Favreau that said, even down to the crack in the walls, we are that accurate, because we went back and looked at it frame by frame, the original movie, and we had to recreate and build this entire set. And he said, it's down to the crack in the rock, accurate. And I thought, that is amazing. I love the attention to detail that these guys have.
Yes. Well, they have every reference in the book, so they should get it pretty close. Yes.
Yeah. It just beautiful stuff. So,
but that's how these guys are, though. You know, it's like they're very respectful, mm-hmm. and they're just like us. They want to see it accurate, so you know, make it accurate.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, they love it so much, and they want to, like you said, pay respect. They want to pay homage to it, and I mean, George Lucas is looking over their shoulder anyway. You gotta impress the boss, mm-hmm. right? Besides everything that we said, just watching Filoni and Favreau control the set and the way they talk to people and the passion that everybody, right down to the gaffer and the guy that's laying tape on the ground or the guy that's moving the lights around, whatever, everybody is so passionate about making sure this show is done beautifully and properly and with respect to all of the stuff that came before it. I want to go get a job. Let me go be the gaffer. I'll lay tape on the ground. Let me be on set and part of this family that is the Star Wars sets.
Yep. Be pretty incredible.
Yeah. So there you go. That's kind of gallery, guys. If you guys want to check out behind the scenes stuff, I suggest having a look at it. It's good.
Well, so what was your thought of just getting the one episode and and overall?
Well, it surprised me, I guess, because we got a full eight episodes last time, and it was basically one for one matching with the show. So the fact that they just did it this way, I don't know. I don't know why they did that. I didn't mind it because I love behind the scenes stuff. I love making of featurettes, so I didn't mind it. I thought it was, I mean, it's like an hour and 5 minutes long or something like that. So,
right.
You know, whereas the galleries were like the other episodes, they're 20 minutes, 15 minutes. They're all different lengths all over the board. So yeah. You really could say they just strung all eight of them together to make the one.
No, well, I think they were a lot longer. I think they were almost 25, 30 minutes, I think, before. So I think we got a lot more of the content. I was surprised that it was only one episode. And yeah. I wasn't that impressed because there were three things that glaringly stood out to me. One, they didn't have an interview with Rosario, right?
Yeah.
They didn't have an interview with Katie Sackhoff. And they didn't ever mention at all Luke Skywalker. So
that's true.
So those things, I think, to me, I was most interested in, like Rosario's opinions and Bo-Katan's, you know, Katie Sackhoff's opinions. I mean, it was, you know, you heard Favreau kind of talk about it on set, but they didn't sit down with those people. They didn't sit down with Mark Hamill about coming back. They didn't sit down with what it went into making or bringing Luke Skywalker to life back in, you know, so many years later. Those are the things I was looking forward to hearing most about.
Now you're ruining it for me, man. Yeah, when you mention stuff like that, it's like, dang. Yeah, they missed out on a lot.
Yeah, oh, totally.
I mean,
yeah, I feel like they rushed through this and made it before, you know, so they could have it ready for Christmas, because that's when it came out, Christmas Day. And I don't think they didn't feel like taking the time to do all those things to properly do some more episodes. So either their budget was lower for this and they didn't really, or they just didn't plan to do a series for this season. But I felt like we got a little shortchanged with it, and I would have loved to see stuff like that in there.
Wow, those are very valid points. Yeah, I don't disagree with you. I mean, it makes me wonder if they never planned to do a sit-down roundtable, because last season they talked to Gina and they talked to, you know, all the different actors and Carl Weathers and everything. So it makes me maybe as part of the actors in this season, maybe Mark Hamill and Rosario Dawson, maybe they're contracted to not have to do that. Maybe, right. I mean, this behind the scenes footage that we got this time was just, you could tell it's just a crew running around behind the scenes with a video camera in hand, just capturing whatever they could. It reminds me of what I do for the expos up here, the Comic Cons, where I just run around behind the scenes with the camera, capturing whatever I can. And they just took that footage and pieced it together. So maybe they didn't even plan for it. And they don't have that footage of interviews and stuff. Because, yeah, I mean, compared to season one of Gallery, they had a set with a table where they all sat around. They actually planned that out and decided they're going to do it. So
maybe. Yeah, that was a fully produced. But that's what, again, that's what made me think, you know, when you look at, when you go to StarWars.com and you click on, you know, they have there at the top there, they have films, series, interactive. When you click on series, Star Wars Gallery is listed as a Lucasfilm series. Because at first I thought, when this came out last year, I thought, okay, well, this Star Wars Disney Gallery is going to be a behind-the-scenes look at several different properties.
Yeah, we talked about that. I agreed with you, yeah.
But it just seems like it's just going to be Mandalorian. And it's just weird that season one would have eight episodes and season two would only have one episode.
Yep.
Like, it's like something happened there or they didn't want to. And it could be that, in all honesty, what it could be is that they wanted to keep all of season two so secretive that they didn't want anybody talking to anybody.
Oh, yeah.
They just wanted to show what they were allowed to go film what they were allowed to go film. They weren't allowed to be there the day that Luke was going to be there. They weren't allowed to be there maybe that much, you know. So I get that. That's probably right. But why not do them later and, you know, still release a couple episodes to get into the more details about bringing Ahsoka back and bringing Bo-Katan back and introducing Luke and stuff like that.
That's a very strong point you make, is that that was probably a security thing. They wanted as little as possible of leaks happening by having other camera crews there filming behind the scenes stuff. So yeah, that's a perfect point, which is probably what happened. And then why not do it afterwards? Once everything's out, hey, we're done. Why not bring everybody back and say, hey, let's talk to these people. What was it like, Mark Hamill, to come back?
I know.
Because he wasn't even mentioned. And it makes me wonder is maybe they stopped behind the scenes stuff before they got to that last episode, because there was nothing. Oh, no, there was a couple of clips of the last episode. There was a couple of scenes with Moff Gideon. They showed him.
A couple things. Yeah,
and they showed the women attacking and stuff. So, yeah, it makes me. Maybe they, like you said, they booted everybody off the set when Mark Hamill was showing up.
Yep.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yep.
Interesting. Well, let's take that note and move into what used to be our bounty section. We're going to get into a bit of a season 2 retrospective.
No, I am your father.
I thought that'd be a good clip to play for looking back on your life. So let's talk a bit about season 2 here. And I wanted to ask you, Vizsla, looking back, how satisfied were you overall with how the season went?
Oh, extremely satisfied. I think that all the rumors that, you know, were getting talked about throughout the year, all the excitement that was built up, I think Favreau and Filoni did a fantastic job laying out the story and incorporating those characters within the story. And it kept you guessing. It kept you guessing, like, what was going to happen with Grogu? Who's this Jedi that's going to answer the call? They advanced the story extremely well, but at the same time, just feeding into our fandom with people like Ahsoka and Bo-Katan and Luke and Boba Fett. I mean, it was just magic how they were able to do all that and push the limits and give us what we wanted. And no, I'm extremely satisfied. I think it was superior to season 1, and I think that it's definitely deserving. Hopefully, you know, maybe I'm not sure it'll win, but getting a Globe nod is a huge recognition for how the season went.
Yeah, well said. I think when you look at season 1, I think in comparison, season 1 was the test. Let's do this. Uh-huh. Let's try it and see what happens. And boom, it's a success. And now season 2 is like, okay, now we can go. And they took off with it. And I look back on it and I'm thinking, there's so much. Because like you said, with the rumors and bringing in all these, you know, guest appearances and, you know, big name actors and bringing animated characters to life, we were worried about this could steal away from Mando and Grogu and his story. Like, you're introducing too much in only 8 episodes. But, man, they found a way to weave it into the story and make it work and make sure the spotlight was still squarely around Mando's mission with Grogu. And it was so, so well done. Yeah, I think overall, I'm extremely happy with it. If I have to rate the season at a scale of 1 to 10... Season 2, I think I'll give it a 9. There's maybe a couple things we could have asked a bit more of, but I think overall I would give season 2 a 9.
Yeah, I'm with you. No, I would say 9.
Yeah.
It's a pretty incredible season.
So, knocking 1 point off of a perfect score, what can you think of that they maybe messed up? What didn't they do right with season 2 that you would knock it that point for?
That's a, man, you know, that's a good question. I think for me, if I were to nitpick the things, and I get why they did it, but continuity wise, I think that like Ahsoka, like her Leku should have been longer, you know.
Yeah.
I know that it caused problems with the way she fought, so I get it, but it would have been nice to see the exact resemblance from last when we saw her in Rebels. I think that what possibly could be a mess up, to be honest, is the explanation of the Darksaber. the whole, oh, you need to fight him now for it. And where that inconsistency of that, how the Darksaber has been passed, I think there's something there that doesn't sit well.
Okay.
A little bit with me.
Right.
Because that was kind of new. And I've talked to a lot of people, obviously, in our show and my Star Wars friends that are like, that part didn't really make sense to me, what I know from the Darksaber in Clone Wars and from Rebels, because he should have been able to just to hand it, concede it to her, you know? So how that plays out, we'll maybe see that in Season 3, but...
Yeah.
I think they handled Grogu really well. So I don't think there was really any mistakes there. You know, Boba Fett, I think I would have liked to maybe get an explanation of how he survived.
But yeah.
We'll probably get that in his story, I'm assuming, his series.
I'd still like to see it, yeah.
Yeah. Well, but other than that, I can't really think of anything else.
Yeah, and maybe not like messing up so much, but things that maybe wasn't perfected, you know, what could they have touched on? What could they have done better? And I think the one little thing that I can think of that I know you and me questioned is at the beginning of Season 2, his mission was to bring Grogu back to his people. And we all thought, his species, yes, his species, find his planet, find his homeworld. And then halfway through the season, it switched to, oh, now I got to bring him back to Jedi, to his kind. Well, yes. And that's only because Mando learnt about Jedi. He didn't know what a Jedi was. He had to hear about it from the armorer. And now all of a sudden the story switched. It's from going from his people to now his kind. And that's where I thought there's a bit, I think that was a writing mishap there. Or they misled us that by saying his people was, oh, they always meant the Jedi. And we just all mistaken that for meaning Yoda species.
Yeah, because I think the armor does say species, but then at some point the conversation shifted to, you know, a race of warriors called Jedi. And then I think Mando was the one that said, you want me to return this person to a race of sorcerers, you know?
That are our enemies, yeah.
Yeah, that are enemies. And she's like, yeah, this is the way. But so there was a little bit of, yeah, a little bit of confusion there. Okay, is it species or is it the Jedi?
Yeah.
It seems like we're not going to get, we're not going to get to know what his species is, you know?
That's a question I have for you. So talking about the whole season as a whole, go back and revisit episode 2, The Passenger with the Little Frog Lady. There was things that we complained about, the fans complained about at large. Do you consider that a bit of a slip up this season as the one episode that maybe, or are you able to look at it now and go, no, you know what, as a sci-fi Star Wars episode, it actually is a really good episode. It's just part of the adventure. Yes, it didn't flow with the overall arc of the season, but when you take it and look at it separate on itself, it's a pretty good darn sci-fi adventure episode.
It was, but I still think that episode is a somewhat of a throwaway episode that you call, you know.
Okay.
I don't think there was too much relevant details in that episode that I think if you went from episode 1 to 3, I don't think you would be missing much.
Yeah, story-wise, for sure.
Yeah, but, story-wise. I mean, you would question why is the Razor Crest all of a sudden destroyed again? But but it was pretty well put together by then. So, yeah, that would be the only thing. Why is it floating in space right now? But I think the story itself was okay. It was not. I did like seeing the spiders. You know, like that was the creature there. Mm-hmm. Was pretty neat, but you know, again, just the aspect of the story moving that along, I don't think it really needed to be in there.
So if Mandalorian was a show that went 20 episodes long, then this one would probably accept this one a lot more, because it's just a good adventure episode in a longer season.
Yeah, I think so. Okay. I think when you're trying to get it all in these 8 episodes,
Yeah,
I think they all got to somehow majorly contribute.
Okay. Yeah, I was just curious. I think my perspective changed on it in that I could enjoy it as the episode that it was. It's just that if you just throw it out there as, hey, here's something Star Wars we did, and you watched it, you'd be like, man, that was actually really cool. Like, because there's a lot of action and thrilling, edge of your seat, you know, sci-fi horror movie. Like, we talked how relatable it was to Aliens, and it just, I mean, that was fun. That stuff was great. So,
yeah. But just to give you a perspective, you know, when I get ready for this show, to do our show, I usually watch at least every episode 3 times, and then I watch it for a 4th time, and I watch it with the subtitles. So I'm watching every episode 4 times. I only watched that episode twice.
Okay. Yeah.
I didn't need to watch it a 3rd or 4th time to get everything.
Because there's no substance to it.
Where the other ones, I had to really make sure I understand what they were saying, and I understood what the places they were saying, and I got the spellings right and all that stuff, and then really followed what the purpose of the things were. But that one is like, yeah, I got it. Two viewings, good.
Interesting. It makes sense. I can't disagree with you, but mm-hmm. I think myself, I just changed. I enjoyed it more looking back on it than maybe what we were hoping for story-wise. Yeah. I get you. So, speaking of episodes then, after looking back on it, what is your favorite of the season? Can only pick one.
Oh, man. That is tough.
Which one? And I want to know why.
It's obviously, for me, it's between Ahsoka and Luke. Mm-hmm. No matter how much I loved seeing live action Ahsoka, I gotta say it's gotta be Luke. I mean, that last episode was it's just jaw dropping to see. So it was really, really good. Probably my favorite.
Okay. Those were the two ones fighting it out for first, and I'm actually gonna pick the other one. I'm gonna say the Ahsoka episode.
Nice. Okay.
And my reasoning, if you really look back at it and compare the two, I think the Ahsoka episode had a little bit better structure, a little bit better story flow from start to finish of the episode itself. I think it just, mm-hmm. I think it flowed a little bit more smoothly. I think there was more involved, like the story carried all the way through, whereas the Luke Skywalker one, I think, we're going to rescue Grogu and, you know, we got to get the team together. We got to fly there or whatever. But I think there's just, that episode should have been longer. I think it should have been fleshed out more to give me that complete feeling of, that was a story from start to finish. So I think that could have been a good 1 hour minimum episode to just add a little bit more to it. Just give it that little bit more polished feel, where I think the Ahsoka episode was so beautiful. And watching Ahsoka, you know, communicate with Grogu and finding out his name for the first time and, you know, and just all that stuff. I think it just edges it out a little bit for me.
Interesting. Yeah, I think what edges it out for me on Luke's side is really, again, never seeing Luke Skywalker like that. Like,
yeah,
if we had seen him be a Jedi like that before, probably wouldn't have been as exciting. But never seeing him do that, it's like Vader in Rogue One, right? We haven't really seen him just take out a bunch of people, and it was pretty amazing. And then, of course, you know, the way they made him look, I know there's big controversy online about if it looks fake or not, but I don't let that stuff bother me. I mean, it was Mark Hamill, and I just love it's just an R2 showing up. I mean, come on. It's like,
I know.
I can't believe you didn't go with R2. That's your favorite droid character, you know? So.
My favorite character, yeah. Like, you can't throw those at me. And like, it's not like it was a far clear victory. I was trying to be very, very strategic in my thinking as an episode. I was trying to deduce the episode as a whole, the composition of the episode and how they put it together. I think the Ahsoka one was better written and better composed and better start to finish put together. But for pure fandom and pure excitement and pure take my breath away, I fell off the couch then yes, Luke Skywalker and R2 showing up at the end, it just, it killed me. I have never had such happy tears in my life. So, yeah. So.
But you asked favorite, not best.
Yeah, that's true. I guess I should put a little slash between favorite slash best episode.
Because Ahsoka probably was the best episode of the season. That was, you know, like you said, the way it was structured, the way that it resembled, you know, the old Kurosawa films, you know, the samurai, you know, and plus it had the Western part of it. It was in the cinematography of it. It was fantastic. Like you talked about earlier, the glowing lightsabers kind of lit her up throughout the forest and stuff like that. So
yeah,
it was probably the best episode overall. I would go along with you on that for sure.
All right, well, let's hand out two gold medals for two different categories then: best and favorite.
Okay.
Ahsoka best, favorite is the Luke Skywalker finale.
Yes.
There we go.
Yeah, see, I think so.
We got to discuss it to figure it all out.
Although the Boba Fett one too is pretty. Oh,
that one wins for best action, I would say. I mean,
yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Boba Fett going to town, like violently, is just sheer joy to watch.
That's right. Yep, getting his armor back. Yeah, that was pretty awesome.
Those are the top three right there.
Yep,
top three. Well, let's look ahead to season three. What can we speculate? Because there hasn't been any leaks, hasn't been any rumors. It's just pure speculation. What do you and me think from this podcast's perspective? What is coming in season three? All I can throw at you is it's got to be going to Mandalore and helping Bo-Katan reclaim the planet. That's what I think it's going to do.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on that. I think it's going to be pretty much centered around Mandalorians and Bo-Katan's plans to, yeah, take back Mandalore.
Yeah.
I don't know what's really in her way, you know? Is the Empire occupied there still? Or, you know, Gideon's not apparently, you know, maybe in the way anymore. Is it Thrawn? Is something else going to be the, you know, the antagonist of this season? That's kind of what we need to debate, I think, going forward. But I do think it's going to center around more Mandalorians and the retaking of Mandalore.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Yeah, that's what I think, and which is fun. I mean, it means Kate Sackhoff gets to be a major part of this episode or of the season, and
yep.
Mercedes, what's her last name? Mercedes,
Sasha Banks
Sasha Banks. Her real name is Mercedes, but yeah, Sasha Banks. She'll also get to be to take part because it sounds like the two of them really get along, and she's going to be a major player. So, as Koska. So yeah, I think that's where it's going. Whether we'll see kind of similar mission based. I don't know. I'm not sure if Greef Karga is going to be involved. I don't know what's going on.
I don't even know if Kara is going to be that much involved, because I have this suspicious feeling that she will be part of the Rangers show.
Yeah.
So.
Or she might go help him. I mean, she might start off helping him, and then maybe the Rangers come and help them as well, because, you know, they're buddies. She seems to have his back, and I mean, if he asks for her help, I don't think she'll say no, but we'll see.
Yeah, but I think we both kind of figured we would have saw a lot more of her in season two than we did.
That's true. We didn't get a lot.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
No. Greef was only in two episodes, I think, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think you're right. I think Katie Sackhoff is going to become more of a prominent character in season three. Sasha Banks, I think we're going to get introduced to more Mandalorians. Hell, we could see, you know, we could see a Sabine still, or maybe even her clan.
Yeah,
you know, from the Rebels series. I think you're going to see a lot of those clans come in. Maybe the more of the Kreese clan. Maybe it's the Ren clan. stuff like that. I think we're going to start seeing more of those families.
Well, yeah. maybe we'll see a couple of Mandalorians come back from season one, like the one voiced by Jon Favreau himself with the Vizsla character.
Vizsla, yeah.
That'd be cool. So leading into speculation, there's a lot of the chatter online has been, will we see Grogu and or Luke again in season three? Do you think they're gone completely? Or when Mando says, I will see you again, does that mean sooner rather than later?
I think it's much later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even still, after this time has passed, it's not.
I don't think we'll ever see Luke again. Although, gosh, you know, I questioned whether or not they were even going to be able to bring Luke into this.
and they did. And there was a rumor. Did you hear the rumor that there's speculation of a Luke show coming because of this?
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
Man.
I mean, that'd be tough.
I don't know.
I think right now I would say we don't see Luke again, and I would say we would see Grogu again just because of that line. But it's going to be towards the end of the series, I think.
Yeah. Okay.
Which, if the rumors are true, that has been out there a little bit, that they've only planned 5 seasons for this show.
Yeah, and it's the talk that I see online about it is that this show, its heart and soul is Mando and Grogu. So you take half of that away, what's going to happen to the show? How long can it be without its heart? You've got its soul, which is Mando, but the heart is Grogu. Can it live without it for very long?
Yeah, and that's a good point, because I think that's why, I kind of feel like that's why they did that one episode. I think it was chapter 15, The Believer, right?
Without him in it at all, yeah.
That didn't have Grogu in it at all. And that was a really good episode.
Yeah. It's, again, a test, right? Can they do it without him?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So I think that was a way to test the waters, and then, of course, have Luke come get him the next episode. And now it's all about Mando's story. Because the show is called The Mandalorian. So it does eventually have to be about him.
Yep. That's true.
And you remember, I think in season one, I speculated. I could have swore I told you, I was like, you know, Grogu's going to be 3 episodes. That's it.
You brought that up. Yeah.
So he lasted all through two seasons.
2 seasons. Yeah.
So I was wrong about that one.
Well, one point here I got, the last one for talking about the season 2 here, in retrospective anyway. You know, I was following the ratings on IMDb of all these episodes, and I was sharing them with you because I thought it was a little bit interesting. By the end, now all this time has passed, can you guess what the top rated episode was?
Gotta be the Luke episode, right?
Yeah, the last one. Because remember, I think it was 9.9 or something by the end of it airing. Well, now that a few months have passed, there's been over 50,000 votes. Chapter 16, The Rescue, is still rated 9.8. That's a lot. And when you look through, I mean, most of the season is rated pretty high. I think the lowest rating was an 8-point-something. So the whole season got rated very, very high. But 9.8 is the final rating for the finale. Yeah. Pretty cool.
Great. Yeah. A lot of people's favorite episode.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, you're going to get all of the diehard Star Wars fans, all the casual fans. Luke Skywalker, what? It doesn't matter. You brought back the most beloved character in the history. So one of. I got a couple of questions here for you about things. Let's look at the season now from a different angle. What didn't we get this season? Questions unanswered. I know we visited this in season one. What kind of things did we not get answers for that we wanted to know by the end of the season? And you already mentioned it kind of earlier. You said Grogu's species and his homeworld. That's something we still didn't get, and I thought we might have. Oh, they gave us his name? All right. We might find out where he's from.
Right.
Never did.
Yeah, and it's still a big question unanswered, that does anybody even know
what his species is?
You would think Ahsoka.
Yeah.
Yeah, you would think Ahsoka maybe. I mean, she said, I only knew one other one like him. You know, it's like, Well, she might even... No one may know. They might be completely missing from the archives or any kind of history book or, you know, species description that this species exists and could be so rare.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's weird that it's one of them Star Wars things where, you know, one of them Easter eggs where you'll never know Yoda's species. You'll never know Grogu's species.
Well, if you think about it, I mean, maybe Yoda and Yaddle came to whatever Jedi stuff without any information. They showed up and they're like, "What? Who and what are you?" "Oh, I'm Yoda." That's it. Yeah. That's all I got for you. And I mean, it'll be interesting to see in this High Republic storyline if Yaddle will ever be mentioned.
Very true.
Because we got a young Yoda, right? So a younger Yoda. Will Yaddle be mentioned in the storyline? Because she's there in Phantom Menace and then she disappears. So
very true.
When did she come into the story? We're going to find out Yoda's earlier story. So yeah, I don't know. Maybe it'll be the High Republic that reveals more Yoda history.
Definitely could be.
Yeah.
Definitely could be.
Yeah. Another question I have here, kind of unanswered, is what happened to Greef Karga? He never showed up again after that one mission, finding out about the base on his planet there.
So was he only in one episode?
I think it was just one episode is all we got him for.
Yeah. So yeah, he's got a lot on his plate now. I think he's running that town, right? He's running Navarro. Mm-hmm. So he couldn't help. Yeah, couldn't help Mando.
I guess not. All we know is he directed an episode. Yeah. That was it.
Now, I got to imagine him coming back for something in season 3.
Yeah, he's part of the crew, right? He's part of Mando's friends, so. Yeah. He's got to show up for something. Speaking of other male characters, what about the Mandalorian that was first with Koska and Bo-Katan? His name was Axe Woves. He never showed up in the finale with the ladies, so where did he go?
I don't know, but I did see a brief interview with Katie Sackhoff, and somebody asked her that. And she said, don't quote me on this, but she basically said that there is a story of why he wasn't there. It's just that they weren't told what that story is.
Oh, okay.
So there's a reason he wasn't in that final episode, and maybe we'll find out. I'm assuming we'll find out in season 3.
Yeah, he might join them if they're going to fight to get Mandalore back. Most likely should be back unless he's dead.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
right. I don't think he's dead. I think he's going to come back.
Cool. Yeah, maybe Bo-Katan just sent him off to get something, track down another shipment of weapons or whatever they were doing.
And, right.
Yeah.
Yep.
So what did they do with Moff Gideon? We never got that answer. Last he was sitting on his ass on the bridge of the ship.
Yeah.
That's the last we saw of him.
Prison.
That's where he is.
It's got to go to prison, I guess. Yeah. You know? I mean, he's a traitor, basically, to the Republic now, and definitely got some war crimes on him, probably has the answer for. So, yeah, he's in prison somewhere.
That's clearly the obvious answer. It just would have been nice to see him put in handcuffs or something, or taken away, or handed off to the, you know, to the police, you could say.
Yeah, but it's probably one of the things where he'll get broken out or something, you know, or he'll get out somehow.
Yeah. Yeah. Something like that. Somebody will break him out. Maybe Thrawn comes for him. Who knows?
True. Yep.
All right, so I got the last question I have, kind of the biggest one I think to get into a little bit here, is why during this entire season were there none of the Mandalorians from season 1 from the Enclave? Like the armor, she never showed up. I was waiting for Mando to go to her and say, hey, what gives? All this stuff you've been feeding me my whole life, it's not true. I mean, she didn't show up. Where and why?
Yeah, that's a big question that went unanswered this season.
Yeah.
Not seeing any of those Mandalorians. Because you would think that he would have some kind of way to find them after they all left Navarro. but all he was able to track down was, you know, some Mandalorian on Tatooine, which ended up not being a Mandalorian. So I think all of that will be answered in season three for sure. I guess the armorer had to find another location somewhere.
Yeah.
And get the other Mandalorians there and kind of start the whole thing again.
But Matt, she's the one, like, she's part of this zealot religious group that Bo-Katan doesn't approve of. So I think those two are going to clash if they ever come face to face. And what is the armorer going to think about them trying to reclaim Mandalore? Is she going to suddenly open her eyes and go, oh my God, like, yeah, okay, let's go save our planet? Or is she, like, there's got to be something there. There's definitely going to be some tension. There's got to be something there because they're completely two different beliefs. And I mean, Bo-Katan just kind of, you know, shriveled up her nose at the whole idea of these people and you religious zealots.
No, very true. I think there's going to definitely be some conflict there.
Yeah.
She's got to, but you know, that's the thing is we totally haven't really been told which is the right way, you know, is the way the armorer and Mando doing it the proper way, the way that the Mandalorians did in years past, or is Bo-Katan, is it that way? Is it just you can take your helmet off and you can fight still, but it's I think that's a big unanswered question, is which this is the way, but is it the right way?
Yeah, this is our way.
Yeah. And how did that come about? And how long has it been like that? And
yeah,
you know, is it only since the Purge has it been like this?
Yeah.
You know, foundlings was another thing that we discovered, you know. Never knew about foundlings. That you could be a Mandalorian but not be from Mandalore.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yep. That'll be very...
So where, you know, you ask, where is she, though? But, you know, I don't know. She's just on a different planet somewhere.
Yeah. I mean, but they've got to get her back in because we saw how well she can fight. She could help them out, so...
Definitely.
Get her to believe. Get her to see the light. I don't know what it is you got to do, but you got to get her on here. I'd love to see her part of the team, and I'd love to see that conflict. I'd love to see how they resolve that.
Right.
Yeah.
Will we see her face? That's another...
Because Din Djarin is awfully comfortable all of a sudden. He seems to be slowly opening up to the possibility that, hey, maybe this is the way is not the way. It's okay to show yourself. And
well, yeah, he's done it already. Might as well just take the helmet off now. And just show your face now. But which I do believe will happen more. I think he'll be more comfortable with that.
Definitely so. That's for sure. And that's a perfect note to end this discussion on, I think, is Mando will show his face more so that we could see the wonderful, talented Pedro acting a little bit more. Because that last scene with him tearing up with little Grogu saying goodbye had me crying like a big baby.
Yes, it did me too.
Ah, yeah. Well, there you go. There's a little bit of a retrospective on season two. Just want to let you guys know we are still around. You might not hear from us for a little bit, but Bad Batch is coming out, guys. And if you want to send in your thoughts or just talk to us and say, hey, let us know if you're going to be joining us for all these other shows, whatever. You know, we're still here. Send us some feedback, and this is how you do that.
If you'd like to be a part of the show, you can send in feedback to themandalorepodcast@gmail.com. And also join our Facebook group. Otherwise, if you don't, we'll put a bounty on your head.
Well, there we go, Vizsla. That kind of wraps us up for, you know, coming back after a couple months. It's nice to be back.
Yeah. It is very nice to be back.
Yeah. Next thing on the list for us is going to be the Bad Batch, guys. So as soon as we find out when that is releasing with episode one, we'll let you know. And that's what you can look forward to. That's when we'll... coming back in your ears here on the podcast.
Yep.
The Bad Batch. Yeah.
We could do one before that, now that you've have seen all of the Clone Wars episodes.
Oh, yeah.
A little different perspective, because before it was only the Clone Wars episodes I was telling you about, right?
That's right. So now I'll have the complete set under my belt. But that means that we're halfway through season three, so that means I actually have to get through it and finish it.
Yeah. Yeah. You got it. You got some time.
You have some time. So, but yeah. You had mentioned off air that we had earlier asked that our fans send us in requests, like yeah. we did last season, if there's anything that they want us to talk about, because last season we got the top 10 lists of all our favorite things in Star Wars, and then we did, what was the other one we did? We did a couple fan-requested episodes. So, again, if you guys want to reach out to us through the feedback email, just let us know, hey, I'd love you to talk about this. We want to hear your thoughts about it, then do so. And it gives us something to, you know, put a show together about. So, yeah.
That's right.
Definitely do that. I think that's really all I got. I mean, you check out Inside the Force. It's still going strong. Check out Council Sessions. Check out Beyond the Saga.
Beyond the Saga. Yeah. And I actually got a new series that's going to be starting up.
Oh.
Also.
Part of Inside the Force.
Yes, it'll be our fourth playlist on our YouTube channel, little series that we're calling Masters of the Order, and it's actually interviews with people that have worked directly on Star Wars projects.
Wow, so, you got some connections happening.
Yeah, and actually, to kind of connect back to what we just talked about, one of my first interviews that we'll be doing is with Claudia Gray.
Nice.
So
nice.
That will be coming sometime in March.
Okay. Fantastic.
Yeah. So I'm working on lining up some people and stuff like that. So yeah,
that's
gonna be fun.
That's exciting. Are you nervous though? Because I know all of a sudden getting to interview people, it gets pretty nerve-wracking.
Not really. We've talked to David Collins and Tom Kane and Steve Bloom, who was Zeb on Rebels. You know, we've talked to some people. So
yeah,
you know, no, I've got some good. It's just the process is a little different, you know, because with actors and stuff like that, you go through their publicists or their agents, you know. But authors like this, which is weird, you got to submit questions beforehand. You got to wait like weeks in order to get like hear back if they're even okay with the questions and stuff like that. You know, usually some of these interviews they do just kind of going off the cuff and things like this. But I've got to have a plan with these questions and stuff. So anyway.
That's exciting, man.
It's going to be neat.
Yeah, it's going to be really neat. That's exciting. That's cool. Well, my podcast news is maybe not that exciting, but fans that love the CW stuff, we just finished doing our season 2 rewatch of Legends of Tomorrow. And during that finale, we have we announced a new show that we're taking on as well. So my other show, Tomorrow's Legends, which covered Legends of Tomorrow and Stargirl, is now added to the catalog Superman and Lois.
Yes.
So we will be covering that, which that
show looks amazing, actually.
It does. That trailer looks cinematic.
Yes.
Wow. So if you guys are looking for a podcast to cover Superman and Lois, then look up Tomorrow's Legends. We'll be doing that. And that show starts February 23rd, so just a couple weeks away from here.
That's right. Yeah. I will definitely be watching that. I'm behind on some of those other ones, but I want to pick that one up right away.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks good. I mean, and this is a Superman story that we have never heard before. I mean, this is a little bit in the future. He's got two teenage boys.
So. But that's because of the result of the crisis, though, right? Because he doesn't really remember them.
Yeah. Well, Lois is pregnant in the crisis, so...
Yeah.
I'm curious. I don't know what the storyline. The synopsis so far is that they return home to Smallville to deal with some family stuff. And, you know.
But the kids are older and, it's.
They don't know he's Superman. So they find out, I think, in the pilot episode, they find out he's Superman. And him and Lois are worried about them gaining any of his abilities because they don't know. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
That sounds. Yeah, that's. Looks really good, though. I like that Superman.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be good.
Yeah. So there you go. So check out Tomorrow's Legends for coverage of that. And we'll be covering Legends of Tomorrow when that comes back sometime in the summertime. And then Stargirl also. We don't know when Stargirl's coming back. It looks like late summer. We'll be covering that as well. So yeah, the catalog is growing. I mean, the tagline we are using is you can't become a legend of tomorrow unless you expand your repertoire. So
nice. Nice.
All right, man. Well, that is all we got for Mandalore. We'll be talking at you as soon as we find out some stuff. And yeah, send us in some ideas. For now, this is Cyber Ren. This is the way.
And I'm D Vizsla. Thanks, everybody. Till next time, we have spoken.
The Mandalore is not affiliated with Disney, Lucasfilm, or Fairview Entertainment. This is a fan-made podcast for entertainment purposes only. All music and sound effects are solely owned by their respective properties.